This VW was a good deal at £650. Our total budget is £1,000, so my mechanic Ed has a healthy £350 for parts, and he's already got plenty of ideas on where to spend it.
I found driving the Golf a particularly entertaining experience, mainly because there's barely any response from the brakes. I've put it up on the ramp. I'm going to see if I can pinpoint the problem. I'm just looking for any dampness around the drum, because that could mean that the slave cylinder is weeping, which would explain the dodgy brakes. This one seems fine, so I'm now going to look at the other three. From what I can see here, there are no leaky brake components, which is not good news, because it means the problem could be under the bonnet. Well, here are the main brake components. You have the servo, and attached to that, you have the master cylinder, and above that, you have the brake fluid reservoir. Now, because it's full of fluid, that confirms there can't be any leaks, which makes me think the fault must be with the seals in the master cylinder. Before I can get at the brakes, I've got to take off the air inlet and the expansion tank. Here are the brake parts from the engine bay. We've got the servo, the master cylinder, and the reservoir. Now you can see from the condition of the master cylinder that it's really rather poor, and my suspicion is that the seals inside have degraded. Now basically, as the name suggests, it is a cylinder, a tube, and inside is a rod and some rubber seals which make up pistons. Now when the rubber seals degrade, they no longer push fluid around, which means you lose your brakes. So I'm going to replace that part with this. Nice brand new shiny one. Okay, now it's time to fit the master cylinder. A nice new shiny one, and I'm hoping this is going to solve our braking problem.
This is quite fiddly. You need to align the master cylinder and the servo, connect them together, and then secure them with some retaining nuts. Now I've fitted the master cylinder, I need to bleed out all the air of the system to make sure that it works to full capacity. I'm filling up the reservoir with brake fluid before I lift the car up on the ramp, and I can loosen the bleed nipples on each wheel.
When you bleed the brakes, effectively what you're doing is opening and closing a valve, and that valve takes the form of this bleed nipple. So whatever system or method you use to bleed your brakes, you're going to end up with a clear tube, which makes a nice airtight seal. And you open up the valve.
I'm using a specialist tool which sucks the fluid through the pipe by creating a vacuum, but you could just get someone to keep pumping the brake pedal for you.
When you see the fluid coming through, you can see here that there are bubbles in it, little air bubbles. And brake fluid isn't compressible, but air is, which is why your brakes wouldn't work if there was air in the system. Once there are no bubbles at all in the line, then you can be pretty confident that it's been bled properly.
One down and three to go, but be careful. Bleed nipples have a habit of rusting on. Don't be tempted to force them with a spanner, as they'll shear off and then you'll be in big trouble. Try a bit of spray-on releasing agent, leave it a bit, and then ease them off. Once all four corners have been bled, it's time to top up the reservoir with brake fluid one last time.
And now for the acid test. Do the brakes actually work? Obviously I could go for a drive, but before I do anything, there's one simple test. If the pedal is hard as nails, then we've got a result. Fantastic. Changing gear in this GTI leaves a lot to be desired. Now the gearbox itself is fine, all the gears are in the right place and they work well. The problem comes when you try and select either reverse or first.
I'm pretty sure that the problem is with the linkage which connects the gear stick to the gearbox. It's worn, which means that when you try to select first, you could just as easily slip into third or reverse, which is a nasty problem if you're sitting at the traffic lights.
Now I'm going to give you a guided tour of the gear linkage. Here is the underside of the stick that I was playing with a second ago. And you can see from this linkage there's a rod. It goes all the way along here to another sort of mechanism, another linkage here. There's a couple of pins and some hinges and stuff, and that goes up into the engine bay and then back along here, some more linkages. And then it attaches to the gearbox just inside here.
Over the years, there's lots of wear and tear on all the bushes, hinges and joints. So the safest thing to do is to strip out and replace the whole lot. Seems a bit daunting, but if you tackle the job methodically, then you should be okay.
Well, that's the main part of the mechanism removed. There are two more linkages I've got to take off, and then I can start the refurbishment. One is here, and the other one is just up inside here. And here we have one of them. And then we have the other one.
A worn gear linkage is a common golf problem, but that's good because a complete repair kit is easily available. Some parts can simply be replaced, others need to be refurbished. But before I can get on with that, there's years of grease and grime to clean off.
I'm going to be reusing these parts, but as you can see, they're really dirty and quite unpleasant. So I'm going to give them a good clean. And this is my parts washer, and I'm going to use this because I've got it. But if you haven't got one at home, all you need is some paraffin and probably a toothbrush is a good start. See how shiny that is? That is well worth cleaning. Makes all the difference.
Now that the components are spick and span, I can fit the new bushes. These are little rubber bungs that just stiffen up the mechanisms and make the gear change much more positive.
Okay, now these joints are nice and stiff, and there's no slack or free play in there, which should hopefully tighten the whole thing up.
This job has taken me about 4 hours so far, and the refitting will take me another two. It's about making sure that you fit the right parts in the right place. If you're worried about doing this job, then a good idea might be to number the parts and mark their position on a sketch, or even better, take a digital picture, which will jog your memory if you get into trouble.
Now, there are a few more fiddly bits to put on after this, but this is the main bit. The main shaft is going back on the car. On your son. I'm just doing up the bearing carrier onto the bodywork of the car, just to hold it in place long enough for me to now put the rubber boot up this end.
Once the rubber boot is fitted, the car can be dropped to the ground and the gear stick reconnected.
Just put the gear stick back in. I'm going to put this pin to connect it to the shaft, and then basically we're done. If I can just take you back to my traffic light scenario, I had no idea what gear I was going to get when I went for first. So now, perfect, straight into first, and if I should need reverse, very, very positive. So fantastic. Now I haven't got to be scared of traffic lights.
Click here to subscribe.